brothers and sisters, to increase your iman. Read the miracle, recite the Quran. Recite it every day and do read it loud. The verses of Quran are all Muslim's pride. This miracle was revealed over a long time span, sent from Allah to an angel, then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creation. He gave us a message, and that was Islam. So read this miracle, recite the Quran.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wal aqibatu lil muttaqeen wa la udwana illa ala zalimeen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidil awwaleen wal akhireen nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa ba'd. My dear viewers, welcome back. Welcome to another live edition of our program Correct to Recitation. We paused the program for almost 3 months due to the COVID-19 and the restrictions. And now, alhamdulillah, this is the first episode after a long absence. May Allah make it easy for all of us, and may Allah accept this humble effort from us. Also, allow me to welcome our studio guest, Sheikh Abdul Khaliq. Finally, we get to see him and meet after a long absence. Brother Muhammad, Brother Ahmed, and Sheikh Abdul Rahman, thank you for joining me in today's program of Correct Recitation. Without any further ado, if you remember, my dear viewers, a few months back we started off Surah Yasin, but we just tackled the beginning and the introduction. So inshallah, I'm going to begin with the meaning of the first ayah of Surah Yasin. It is chapter number 36. It's a Makki surah. It was revealed before the migration, and if one of its verses was recited as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leaving from his house while the Meccans were besieging his room in order to attack him. وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصُرُونَ. And this blessed surah consists of 83 ayahs. And we also spoke about the numerous ahadith which are either fabricated or extremely weak, irrespective of the superiority of Surah Yasin and specific virtues which cannot be confirmed. The entire Quran is blessed. Surah Yasin is one of the surahs of the Quran, but it is neither the heart of the Quran, nor if you recite it for anything, it will be fulfilled. The whole Quran is blessed. The whole Quran is used as means of cure, as means of ruqya, as means of fulfilling your needs. But to mention a specific surah or ayah of the Quran with a specific virtue, you need a sound reference. So when I say, Sheikh, what is the greatest ayah in the entire Quran? And then I say it is Ayatul Kursi. Correct, because there is a sound hadith. What is the greatest chapter in the entire Quran? Everybody would say Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book, Surah Al-Fatiha. I would say you're right, because there is a sound hadith in this regard. Without any further ado, we're going to listen to a beautiful recitation. Finally, we're going to listen back to Sheikh Abdul Khaliq and Sheikh Abdul Rahman, both of whom would recite from the beginning of Surah Yasin through ayah number 12. Without any further ado, Sheikh Abdul Khaliq, please go ahead.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ياسين والقرآن الحكيم. إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم. تنزيل العزيز الرحيم. لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون. يس الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم. لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون. لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون. إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون. وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون.
وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون. إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم. إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين.
ما
MashaAllah. Barakallahu feekuma. May Allah bless you both. Beautiful recitation. Yasin, the first word in this blessed surah, chapter number 36, the Mecca surah, which consists of 83 ayahs, is one of the letters which are put together similar to Alif Lam Mim, Kaf Ha Ya Ayn Sad, or Alif Lam Mim Sad, out of the 28 Arabic alphabet, which Allah the Almighty was challenging the Arab through them, saying, this is your language, those are your letters. Can you bring anything similar to that, as eloquent as that, as wise and perfect as that? And then he challenged them to gather all the experts to bring even 10 chapters, one chapter, one ayah, and they failed. So it is similar to Alif Lam Mim, and this is the opinion of the vast majority of the commentators of the Quran and the interpreters of the glorious Quran. There are some who said, Ya is a calling letter. So he is calling on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Yasin, why? They said, look, in the third ayah and after the oath, the subject of the oath is Innaka la min al mursaleen. So, oh yo, then indeed you look beautiful. So it sounds like, you know, the calling letter was followed by a name, and that's why you find many people call their sons Yasin. As a matter of fact, the one who's directing this episode right now, his son is Yasin. So Yasin, according to some of the commentators of the Quran, is a name or one of the names of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But this is mere ijtihad. It doesn't have any sound proof or reference. Or otherwise, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned his names. So we know what is the meaning of Al-Mahi, what is the meaning of Al-Khatam, what is the meaning of Al-Mustafa. Anyway, other Mufassirin said, Yasin isn't a name. Ya is a calling letter. It's like, oh, yo, oh, you. And then Sin is the first letter of the word Sayyid. Ya Sayyid, O Master, O Chieftain of humanity, O Messenger of peace and Messenger of all mankind and the jinn, Ya Sayyid. Even though I love this interpretation, but I cannot say this is the absolutely correct one. It is also some sort of ijtihad from some of the Mufassirin. And the ijtihad is not to be dismissed, because it is followed by addressing Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the second person, the pronoun innaka, indeed you are, ka, second person. So why not, maybe? So the amana requires me to give you the opinion of the vast majority of the Mufassirin, and also if there are other opinions. I know some people would meet somebody by the name and saying, you know, it's haram, man. You know, you gotta change your name. Well, it is one of the opinions of the scholars. Or Yasin, يعني يا سيد. There is, in some words, there is one letter which is like a bell. Once you say it, it rings a bell. Such as in the word Sayyid, it is the most ringing bell letter in the word Sayyid. Sin, ya, dal. So it's like Yasin, يعني يا سيد. This is one of the opinions, as I mentioned earlier. Anyway, what is it all about? Yasin, whether Allah is mentioned it as letters similar to Alif Lam Mim, and only Allah knows their meaning, or it is Ya Sayyid or O Muhammad by another name. Allah is swearing. Allah called him and he said, I swear to Al-Quran Al-Hakim. When you say Al-Quran, the glorious book of Allah, is the only book which is called Quran. And it is the only book which is called Kitab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it Al-Kitab, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. It was written from day one. From the moment the revelation was revealed to Muhammad, peace be upon him, he would call Ali ibn Abi Talib, Ubay ibn Ka'b, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, and many others, Zayd ibn Thabit. Go ahead and write down those revelations. That's called Kitab. They didn't have papers, but they had, you know, the clavicle bone of a camel. you know, my, here's my clavicle bone. Okay? It's kind of small. But the clavicle bone of a camel is very broad. So it's like several pages. They used to write on this clavicle bone once it dries up. They used to write on the tanned animal skin, okay, the inner part of it. They used to write on that. They used to write on the parts of the trees. So all of that piled up like a mountain of documents of the Quran. Then later on, it was all compiled in what is known as Mus'haf, from cover to cover, written on papers. That is Kitab. And why was it called Quran? Qara'a is a root word, the past tense of read in Arabic. Of read, read. So, Qara'a, he read. Qira'a is reading. Quran, because not just that it will be read. We used to have a subject in middle school, in high school, Qira'a, reading. But this is Quran, because this is not any sort of reading. This is the most frequently read book ever. Quran being read and recited 24/7. Sheikh Abdul Khaliq done, Abdul Rahman has started, Ahmed is going to resume, Muhammad will take it from there. And there are hundreds of millions of believers are reciting the Quran at the same time or one after another without agreement. So it is the most frequently read and recited book, Quran all the time. Okay, what about Al-Hakim? Hakim, you know, when you deal with me and you say you're a very Hakim person, you're a wise person. Okay, that makes sense, right? But when you hold the book and you say, this book is Hakim. Hakim is to describe somebody. A person, not a book. So why did he say Al-Hakim? And the meaning is the book which is full of hikmah. The book which is full of hikmah. Whoever follows that book will be successful, both in this life and in the hereafter. So because it is full of hikmah, you will enjoy your life here and you will see salvation there if you follow this hikmah. So why didn't he say that the book full of hikmah? Simply because the book was not handed over to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a book. Here, take this book of hikmah. No. Because the book was said by Allah. So Allah didn't create it. He created everything between two letters, B and it is. To the heavens, to the earth, to the human being. Okay? إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. But the Quran didn't. He didn't say the Quran. Be Quran. And then he said, Ya Jibreel, give it to Muhammad. Nope, not with the Quran. The Quran belongs to Allah because it is one of his traits. It is his speech. You really mean it? You mean that when you say, إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, Allah actually spoke those words and letters. And he said to his messenger, indeed you're one of the messengers, whom I have sent? Yes, indeed, this is what it means. Every word in the Quran from beginning to end, from cover to cover, is the word of Allah. He said it, not created it. The Quran isn't created. This is the corrupt belief of the Mu'tazila and the people who follow them. It's a corrupt belief. This is a deviant belief. But the correct belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke it out. And that's why he said Hakim. When he describes the Quran, his word, يعني he's describing whom? Himself. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ كَانَ حَالِفًا فَلْيَحْلِفْ بِاللَّهِ أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. It isn't permissible to swear to anything other than Allah or his names or attributes. So I cannot say it's haram to say I swear to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though he's most beloved to me, I cannot. I cannot say I swear to my mother's life or to my grandmother because I love my grandmother so much. I cannot do that, okay? But I can say Wallahi, Tallahi, Billahi, Warabbi al-Kaaba, the Lord of the Kaaba, the Warabbi al-Arsh, the Lord of the throne. But what about if I ask you, is it permissible to say Wal-Qur'an al-Majid, I swear to the Qur'an. You, not Allah. Can I say, Abdul Rahman is asking me, really? For real? You swear? I said, I swear to the Quran. I'm telling the truth. Am I doing the right thing? Well, if you mean the Quran, the word of Allah, this is one of his traits, then this is perfectly fine. Like when you say, Wal Hakim al Khabir, I swear to Allah, this is his description. So Al Quran is his word, and it is described as Hakim because it is his word. So when you say Al Hakim, you mean Al Hakim has revealed word full of wisdom. And what is Hikmah? What does it mean, Hikmah? Hikmah in Arabic, as our teachers used to instruct us, وَضْعُ الشَّيْءِ فِي مَوْضِعِهِ وَضْعُ الشَّيْءِ فِي مَوْضِعِهِ. In brief, you know, we have 3 or 4 cups of tea. We have big ones and small ones. So, when the waiter gives Sheikh Abdul Khaliq the bigger one, because he's a big Sheikh, that's a Hikmah. Then he gives Abdul Rahman, or he gives me the little one, that's a Hikmah. But when he switches, I say, this guy is lacking Hikmah. He puts things not in the right perspective. So I'm just giving you an example because I know that among the viewers, some who are minors and kids. Okay? So when you make the right decision, that is Hikmah, wisdom. When you do the right thing, that is Hikmah. When you say what is right at the right time, this is Hikmah. You know? You meet somebody who's a teenager, and you know teenagers, they develop acne. Oh my God, oh, what is this? All acne. And you're making even him more depressed. Even after you say this, I do apologize, I didn't mean it. This is a person who's lacking of Hikmah. He's not Hakim. Look, the Hikmah presented how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, يستحب التنفيس في الأجل. It is recommended to give glad tidings to somebody who is severely ill. You went to the hospital. Now the COVID-19, there are no empty beds. So you picked up the phone, you spoke to somebody, and or you visit somebody who's terminally ill, and you say, no, don't worry about it. MashaAllah, hundreds of people had COVID-19 and they recovered. And guess what? The good news, that when you recover, MashaAllah, you'll be immune. Lucky you. So you convert the calamity into a prosperity. You make him feel happy. Okay, even if the doctor said he's not going to make it, only 3-4 days, he's terminally ill. So you say, oh, my uncle was like that and he made it. Lakin Hikmah is when you say, oh my God, you have this, I asked the doctor, you know, you may not make it. My cousin actually had the same and he died innocently. Lakin Hikmah, right? This is stupid, not Hikmah. إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. For every oath, there is a subject of the oath. So when you say, Wallahi, Wallahi, I swear to Allah. What? Say it. What do you want to say? What you want to say after the oath is called جواب القسم, or the subject of the oath. What do you want to confirm? Allah says, I swear to the book of me, the Quran, the most frequently read book, the book which is full of wisdom. Ya Muhammad, indeed I have sent you. You're one of the messengers of Allah whom I have sent. Subhanallah. To do what? To do what? على صراط مستقيم. This is the ultimate goal of the believers in this dunya, to maintain steadfastness on the straight path, and of everyone in the hereafter. الصراط المستقيم, the entire religion, the entire belief revolves around that term, صراط مستقيم. You praise Allah, you glorify Him, you exalt Him, then you ask, what is the ultimate request? اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Guide us to the straight path. Which path is it? Neither the path of those who want to stray, nor the path of those who earn your anger. Yes, you send messengers to them, and they rejected them. And that's why they went astray, and that's why they have been cursed by you and accursed by their own prophets. No. We don't want to be like them. Want to maintain steadfastness on As-Sirat al-Mustaqim. That's why he sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is As-Sirat al-Mustaqim? To do what? Tanzeel al-Aziz al-Rahim. Wait a minute. This is really amazing. Subhanallah. The book of Allah, which he swore to in ayah number 2, Now is explained in ayah number 5. This revelation, this Quran, the most frequently read book, have been sent. It is the Tanzil, it is the revelation of the Almighty, the Most Merciful. A book which gathers between firm laws and constitution and full of mercy must be full of hikmah. لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه. تنزيل من؟ تنزيل من حكيم. That's why the book is حكيم. It's full of wisdom. Because who revealed it? حكيم. حميد, worthy of praise. Because والله without this book will go astray. Our life will be messed up. Let me give you a quick example. I meet with a lot of people who become atheists or pro-homosexuality and so on. I just give them an example. The countries which are so far considered advanced countries, some countries in Europe, for instance, they rejected God totally, and they believe that we were created by accident without a creator. And that's why they jump from one conclusion to another, from with regards to the sexual relations, it is messed up. They are suffering of depression in the number of their population. They're asking for refugees in order to raise their kids so they become like them. In a matter of a decade or two, you will not find people. Because when this generation dies in a few decades, they don't have offspring. Very few children are born. This is what happens. But when everybody becomes a homosexual, for instance, where would you get children? Huh? How would you get children? How would you have an offspring? So when the Quran says this is halal and this is haram, you gotta do this and you gotta abstain from that. It's full of wisdom. Why? Because it doesn't tackle nor handle matters which are momentarily and only for the time being. It is rather forever. And that's why when Allah sent Adam and Eve to earth, He said, فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي guidance. Once you receive guidance from me, ذكر, the Quran. So whoever will follow this guidance shall never go astray, nor shall they suffer of any distress. But those who reject it, their life will be miserable, as it is miserable now for such people. And by the end, they take their lives. They are searching for happiness, but in the wrong place. They are searching for happiness in the dumpster, in dirty places, in tunnels. Happiness is when you ascend up, when you deal with the omnipotent, when you deal with the Creator and ask Him, how can I be happy? Okay. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He sent that book because He is the Almighty and He is the Most Merciful in order for you, لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ فَهُمْ غَافِلُونَ. In order to warn people whom their fathers and their forefathers were not warned. يعني they have not received messengers before you. And accordingly, they're living in darkness and they are negligent of the fact that they were created to worship one God and there will be life after death and so on. Al-Imanu billahi wa liyum al-akhir. So the ayah says, مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ. Somebody will say, I caught a mistake in the Quran, but there have been many messengers before. Yeah, we know that. And the Quran said, there are many, many messengers. At least the Quran listed the names of 25 of them. Okay? But there is something called Al-Fatra. Al-Fatra is a pause between each two messengers or two messengers. Yani, from Nuh alayhi salam and after the flood, there came Hud, who was sent to the people of Ad. And he's an Arabic prophet. He was sent in the peninsula, by the way. And after him, there came Prophet Saleh to the people of Thamud on the borders between or on the way in the peninsula, on the way to Asham. There came Prophet Shu'aib. There came Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Ibrahim was in Iraq. And then when he traveled, migrated to Asham. And he resided in the Holy Land. Then he visited Egypt, and you know the story. Then Allah blessed him with a son from Hajar. He deposited him where? In the peninsula. In Mecca. In Mecca. Okay? Then he traveled back. He deposited his son in Mecca. Then he traveled back to Asham, where Allah blessed them again with Ishaq or Isaac. And from Ishaq, Yaqub, and then tens or hundreds of prophets of Bani Israel. We know the names of many of them. But Ismail alayhi salam, who started what is known as Al-Arab al-Musta'riba, because he was an Arab, but he resided there, and he dealt when he got married from the tribe of Jurhum, and he became an Arab. He learned the Arabic language, and he became a prophet to the Arab, Ismail alayhi salam. Then Ibrahim came and visited him, and they built the Kaaba in Mecca. Okay? From Ismail alayhi salam, all the offspring of Ismail alayhi salam to Muhammad, there was no prophets, only Muhammad. That is thousands of years. Isa alayhi salam, or Jesus peace be upon him, was the last messenger to the Israelites. And he was born 570 years before the birth of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam. So the Arab, since Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son Ismail, had no clue. They were missing the point, and that's why many of them ended up worshipping idols. And that's why Allah sent you, He said, we sent you to warn people. مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ. Their fathers and their forefathers, it's been a while, they haven't received a messenger. لَقَدْ حَقَّ الْقَوْلُ عَلَىٰ أَكْثَرِهِمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Unfortunately, many of them will never believe. He already listed some names in the Quran, like Abu Lahab. He will never believe. Abu Lahab could have been smart to say, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله, and by that he will belie the Quran and make people deny the Quran. But he didn't, and he died as a disbeliever. Likewise, Abu Jahl, Ubay ibn Khalaf, Umayyah ibn Khalaf, and so on. So they insisted on dying in disbelief to confirm the word of the Quran. فهم لا يؤمنون. Why? Why didn't they take heed? Nowadays, a lot of people, whether watching this program or whenever we travel for da'wah or in the flight, a lot of Americans accept Islam on a daily basis. A lot of Europeans, a lot of Africans, a lot of Asians, a lot of Russians, alhamdulillah. But all of those people are not Arab. They don't understand Arabic. How do they accept Islam? By the meaning. Some people accept Islam when we give them da'wah in the flight, in 2 hours. They accept Islam and they become better Muslims than many those who were born in Islam. Since December until now, Huda platforms have over 3,500 and maybe 10 new Muslims. None of them is an Arab. None of them is an Arab. So what made those people take heed, accept the da'wah, become Muslims, even though not Arab? And while the Arab, they read the Quran, they hear Muhammad, they have the messenger, they see the miracles, and they don't take heed. The ayah says, ayah number 8, and I will end up with it to take a break. He says, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا فِي أَعْنَاقِهِمْ أَغْلَالًا فَهِيَ إِلَى الْأَذْقَانِ فَهُمْ مُقْمَحُونَ. Wow! Verily, we have put on their necks iron collars reaching to the chins so that they their heads are forced up. What does it mean? I still didn't understand it. When somebody is handcuffed, his mobility is controlled, is limited, is under control. And this is what the cops do once they arrest somebody. They handcuff him here or from behind. What about if those hands are cuffed to the necks? Everyone's hand is cuffed to his neck. It's terrible. You know what it means? So there is like an iron collar raised all the way, and the person doesn't have a chance to look right, nor to look left, or to look down. He is stuck, like having a dead end. You know, such people, when I have debates with atheists, and they're defeated, utterly defeated, whether on scientific basis, or logic, or philosophy, and by the end, one of them would say, look, doctor, you make sense. I trust you in the debate, but guess what? I'm not changing. I still will not believe in God. One of them said, you know what? Yes, I'm convinced. All what you said is true. But even if Darwin is brought back to life and he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, I ain't saying it. Oh, this is what Allah said. They're stuck. They don't see nothing but disbelief. They do not recognize any truth around them. Such people, if they see the sun in the middle of the sky, they say, there is no sun there. There is no light. Because Allah put a seal over the eyes. They cannot see. May Allah protect us against that. May Allah guide us what is best. We'll take a short break. excuse me. We'll take a short break, then inshallah we'll be back in a couple minutes. We'll open all the phone lines for you guys to start reciting those beautiful verses of Surah Yaseen. Please stay tuned.
Recite it every day and do read it loud. Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. As you all remember, if you still remember, and for the new viewers, in correct recitation, the second segment we dedicated to take your calls, whoever is interested to recite, to imitate the beautiful recitation of the two sheikhs, will be more than happy, inshallah, to take your call. We're reciting from ayah number 1, the first ayah of Surah Yaseen, through ayah number 12. The first three quarters of a page, inshallah. So let me remind you with our phone numbers. If you're interested, please give us a call right now, inshallah. The phone numbers beginning with area code 002, then 02-3855-131. Alternatively, area code 002, then 01-005-469-323. And two WhatsApp numbers, area code 001-347-806-0025. And finally, area code 001-361-489-1503. Also, inshallah, in the upcoming episodes, we will be doing the calls via Skype, like we promised Fatima from India. Inshallah, she can participate with us, or we can get to see her while she's reciting, and so on. While waiting for your calls, inshallah, we'll take our brother Muhammad from the studio, please, from the beginning of Surah Yaseen through ayah number 12.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Yaseen. Wal Qur'anil Hakim. Innaka laminal mursaleen. Ala siratin مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين.
أحسنت أخي، بارك الله فيك محمد. Sister Asia from the KSA is on the line. السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Welcome to the program, Sister Asia. Are you calling in to recite today?
Yes, Jazakallah.
Okay. From the beginning of Surah Yaseen, please.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ياسين والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول ولا أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلال فإن إلى أتقان وهم مخمهون.
Okay, we're gonna say it together, Sister Asia. We're gonna say it together, inshallah. إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا. Can you say that?
Yes,
repeat it.
I can get it.
Okay, I'm gonna recite it. One segment at a time and repeat it after me. إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا.
إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا.
فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون.
وإيا إلى الأذقان فهم مخمهون.
Beautiful. Now, Sister Asya, I want you to watch my throat. I'm going to pinpoint with the pen to the exact articulation point of two letters, which if we adjust them and we know where they come from, it will make a big difference in your citation. There are six letters. Just watch me. There are six letters. Normally they come from the throat, but the throat isn't just one segment. It's big, it's long. So that's why there is what is known أدنى الحلق and there is أوسط الحلق and أقصى الحلق. There is the nearest part of the throat to the mouth cavity and there is the middle part and there is the farthest part of the throat, okay, to the from the farthest part from the mouth cavity, which is going down. So as far as the six letters are the Hamza and the Ha, Al-Ayn wal-Ghayn والحاء والخاء. Okay, those are the six letters. The همز والهاء. الهمزة and الهاء. همزة is different than the هاء. They come from the upper part, the nearest to the mouth cavity. Okay? And then we have العين and الحاء. It's a little deeper than the هاء. So that's why when you say فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون. مقمحون. It is a little deeper than the ha. You see, فهم. فهم. How do you actually adjust that? You know, in Urdu, you have the same Arabic letters, but different writing. So the ha, if you put jazm, you call it jazm, it's sukun in Arabic. And you precede it with an alif. You put on any letter, jazm, sukun, and you precede it with an alif, let's say alif with fatha, it will give you sharply the exact articulation point. So, the ha, I would say, ha with sukun preceded by an alif with fatha. So I would say, ah, ah. Yes, I know where it comes from now. I can even point with my index finger. I can feel it. So try to say, for the ha, ah, which is a little deeper, okay? So you say Ahmad, Ahmad, okay? Alhamdulillah, because if you go a little up, you say Alhamdulillah, and you know how many people in Mecca, they say, you know, I want to go to a haram. No, it's not haram, it's haram. Why do they confuse the haram with the haram? Haram is in Egypt, pyramid. Haram is different. It is a sanctuary. Haram, haram, because the ha is deeper than the ha. So you say, فهم مقمحون. And Sister Asia, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to educate everyone. As I said, that this program is dedicated to non-Arab. People are learning and struggling. No one should hesitate to call in to learn how to read the word of Allah correctly. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, these guys, mashallah, they get a lot of reward. Al-mahiru bil-Qur'ani ma'a safaratil kiram al-barara. You heard his recitation, you heard Sheikh Abdul Khaliq and Abdul Rahman, beautiful, right? So mashallah, if they also act upon it, they will be in the ranks of the noble angels. They are as good as angels. Okay, and you're going to listen to Brother Ahmed right now as well, inshallah. When somebody hears these guys, you shouldn't feel, oh my God, I can never read like them. No, you can definitely read like them or even better than them. A lot of people have come from the UK, from the USA, to study Quran from the scratch and take ijazah. Okay? And they did. Not ijazah only in one dialect, in the 10 dialects, mashallah. So they were non-Arab. You don't have to come. You can sit at the convenience of your house and learn online or while watching this program, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Ummu Ahmed from Australia, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sister Ummu Ahmed, welcome to the program, and you can proceed on and recite from the beginning of Surah Yasin.
Okay, from beginning I start, inshallah?
Yes.
Okay. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ياسين والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز
تنزيل
يا سوري تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون.
حسبك ما شاء الله. أم أحمد from Australia, beautiful, ما شاء الله, thank you so much. محمد 10 years old from KSA. Assalamu alaikum, Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum, Muhammad. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, Muhammad.
How are you? Alaikum salam.
Where are you from originally?
Fine. I'm in KSA, but I'm from Kenya. I'm in KSA now.
From Kenya, mashallah. Go ahead, Muhammad, and recite from the beginning of Surah Yasin.
Okay. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ياسين والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم فهم غافلون. لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون. إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون. وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون.
حسبك يا محمد، بارك الله فيك. محمد from Kenya, beautiful, جزاك الله خيرا. He's 10 years old. We have a question from one of the sisters who says, is it possible for an elder person to learn this at a later age, like in the 20s? Are you kidding me? I used to have a student, Dr. Ron from Austin, Texas, where I lived in Texas. He was a priest. He accepted Islam. He didn't know an Arabic word, and he was my student. I was in my 20s, and he was in his 70s. MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. And he was a doctor, and I was just a beginner. He was a priest, okay, and a doctor. So in any case, there is no age limit. Do you think that the Sahaba, Abu Bakr and Umar, these guys were young and they learned the Quran at a young age? Nope, that is not true. And also, this Quran isn't only for the Arab. And do you think, if we step out of the studio and browse around in Cairo, or go even to some universities and ask people, whether in Cairo or in Mecca or in any of the Arabic countries, in the street, go ahead and read the Quran, they will read it easily just because they're Arab? No way. That is not right. That is not true. Rather, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ. Only those who studied and learned how to read the Quran will read it, will be able to read it. Whether they are Arab or non-Arab, from China, from Russia, from the States, from Europe, from Latin America, it doesn't matter. But those who were born, wallahi, in Mecca, in the sanctuary of Mecca, they did not join the school, they did not learn how to read the Quran, they will not be able to read it. إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ. It is your call. And the good news is, while struggling to learn, these guys are with the noble angels. They get 10 good deeds for each letter they recite because they know how to recite it. The Messenger of Allah, the man who is full of mercy, said, and for the person who is struggling to read it, will receive double reward. I know we ran out of time, but I want you to listen to Brother Ahmed before we leave, inshallah. Couple verses. Can you please recite, وَسَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ.
وسواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون. إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر وخشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم. إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين.
أحسنت، بارك الله فيك، جزاك الله خيرا. Brothers and sisters, we ran out of time. Until next week, I leave you all in the care of Allah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
This miracle was revealed over a long time span. sent from Allah to an angel then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creation. We were chosen to be part of his nation.